What do you do when your financial flex flops? We're going to be talking with Dennison today, sharing with us how he had that financial independence flex and the pandemic just wrecked his plans. Find out what he did. Welcome to the Ultimate Crowdsourced Personal Finance Show. This is Choosify. All right, guys, today we're talking with Dennison, and he has an absolutely incredible story here, and we're going to really just dive straight into the weeds on this, but we're going to get a chance to explore how to unlock that flexibility, how to replace fear with flexibility, and how to focus on that aggregation of marginal gains and see what the world unlocks. And with that, Dennison, like, give us a little sense for how does your money story really begin here? I mean, it's kind of counterintuitive, right? Like, most people are just trying to get into a career and you're already thinking about, how do I build my life?
Yeah. I've always kind of been into learning. That's kind of the values that's been instilled into me by my parents. They left their home country of the Philippines around the age of 24, 25 to a completely new country. And they gave up a better part of their, I would say, like, youth to kind of give me a better life. And the one thing that they always instilled in me was education. And so I think, in the broad sense of the term, not just like schooling education, but always be learning. So reading books growing up, picking up different skills that I was really uncomfortable in. Like, I joined different sports teams, taught myself different skills, not just like in school type of skills, but like different life skills, mental skills as well. Like, a really random fact, I trained myself how to not shiver when I was in the high school swimming team, just because it was like, the pool is cold, and I didn't
want to shiver. You're basically talking, Brad will say more about this, but you're basically talking, you were a predecessor to the Wim Hof method. Is that what you're describing here?
If that's what the Wim Hof method is, yes.
He probably learned it from you.
That's crazy. I love that concept of not only education, but just looking for these ways to just like overcome something. I saw actually on your LinkedIn profile that Toastmasters was prominently placed there in your university days. Is that something? I know, obviously, public speaking is something that's extraordinarily difficult for so many people. I know I've talked about this on the podcast, how speaking in public was the biggest fear of mine in the entire world, which is why it's so ironic that I'm on a podcast, which is hilarious to me to this day. But talk to me about that.
Yeah, Toastmasters was something I did back when I was in college. And it was also something I did in my first job. It was just something that I really wanted to develop, public speaking, because when I saw really good public speakers, I was like, wow, they can really convince a room to get on board with what they're saying. To this day, still don't think I'm a great public speaker. So it was something that I joined to kind of improve myself, kind of like what I was talking about earlier, with just trying to do the uncomfortable and talking about anything for like a minute, which is one of the exercises they make you do in Toastmasters, was something that I was definitely uncomfortable with.
I feel like I can nail any topic for a minute. I am thoroughly incapable of hitting any topic for 2 minutes. Which is why, you know, sometimes when you take that, like when you're walking around your neighborhood and you sync up with a neighbor and it wasn't someone you were necessarily planning on talking to and you didn't have any canned thing to talk about and you're going in the same direction and you're like, oh man, I'm going to run out. I'm definitely going to run out of something interesting to say.
It is amazing. Thinking about like the talent stack that we're constantly talking about, it reminded me actually of a quote from Warren Buffett that I just dug up in the last 30 seconds here. So it was Warren Buffett says this one skill will boost your career value by 50%. And he actually says that it's public speaking. He was speaking to a group of college students at Columbia, and he was saying, right now I would pay $100,000 for 10% of the future earnings of any of you. So if you're interested, see me after class. And then he said, now you can improve your value by 50% just by learning communication skills, public speaking. If that's the case, see me after class and I'll pay you $150,000. So 50% increase right there. And actually, Jonathan Scott Adams, in his book that we always talk about, the talent stack, he prominently features public speaking. So it's interesting to see that thread.
It is a valuable skill for sure. You know, Dennison, I was looking at you, as you look at your story and I made note, you know, you're coming from an immigrant family from the Philippines, and we were talking a little bit about your money story. I wanted to maybe just spend a couple minutes talking about, you know, financial security and money lessons gleaned from parents, you know, what you actually saw and what you didn't see growing up, and maybe that'll help us kind of get a little bit better sense for, you know, why you were so interested in this financial independence concept a little bit later on. So could you give us a sense for what money lessons did you really glean from your parents?
Yeah, I hadn't had a chance to really reflect on it until my later years, but I really learned a lot about frugality and just the value of money from my parents, mainly in how they lived and how we lived as a family. So for example, my mom works as an occupational therapist, and she worked two jobs, still working two jobs my entire life. She would work full time, and then on the weekends, she would take on a second job. And then my dad would work on in the evenings as a, well, he started out as the person who would clean the airplanes after every time it landed. And then he moved up to ground service technician. And so how that played into my life was basically one parent was always working, and then the other parent was there to take care of me, or I was in school. But that I never saw a babysitter, for example.
Okay.
Yeah. And my dad would like cook us meals. So like we had food covered.
Yeah.
Like I'm pretty sure our food budget was pretty small.
So just like, you know, the high level here, we have incredible work ethic and frugality. Those two pieces are absolutely covered. And I'm curious, you know, so we have earn more, hustle your tail off. And then you also have keep it lean, right? You live within your means. So hopefully we have a gap, some sort of difference, some form of savings. Did you learn anything on the investing side?
No, actually. My parents' knowledge kind of just stopped at save as much as you can. In terms of the invest more side, that was something that came a lot later, especially towards the end of my graduate studies. My dad talked to me and said, hey, this investing thing, like it was something that I never really learned. And it was something I wish I could have taught you, but you're young, you have a chance to learn, figure this out, because I know you can. And that was kind of like the jumping off point for me to like, okay, I have the skills to be able to learn this. Like, let's do this.
That must have been such a cool moment, right? Like a father-son moment. I'm picturing that. It was the implication that you were going to learn it and then teach him potentially? Or was it just, hey, son, I trust you, go out and do this?
So not at all the teach me type of thing, because he actually ended up trying to learn it by himself.
Yes. Oh, that's fantastic.
Yeah. Very cool. And so he'll check in on me every now and then and be like, hey, have you like figured out more about investing? And in my mind, I'll be like, I'm just following the simple path to wealth. And
Hang on. We definitely skipped in a huge step there. And I'm really curious, like he says, hey, son, I've given you everything that I can. I've set you up for success. I've put the emphasis on industry and education and frugality. You've got these tools, but now you're going to have to figure out this next bit because I never had time. And I know it's important. So go figure it out. So you're going to college, and there's probably some lessons that we should look there in terms of, you know, how you approach that. But I'm genuinely curious, when you went out and you explored, how did you land on the simple path to wealth? Walk me through that kind of learning curve, because there are so many options for getting started and there's so many bad ones.
Yeah, well, I was pretty set because the saving more side was already like dug into me. Like I could live out of a backpack, and I was living out of a backpack when I was in college, kind of like Brad wanting to live out of a suitcase. Like I already got that set.
Nice reference. Thank you.
Yeah. And then around 2017 was when I started like looking more into this. And that's when Choosify, like in the early days, that's when I was like, oh, this is like perfect. If I didn't have Choosify, I don't think I would be where I am like now in terms of my knowledge, like financially.
That is amazing. So you found us way, way, way back when we first started, right? Do you have any recollection of how you came across us when nobody had heard of us?
Yeah, really. I used to actually ask people, can I interrupt you before you answer that? We used to get like occasionally emails from people, just like occasionally, like one comment here and there, or one person left their review. And I was like, I would always message them, how did you hear about us? How did you find us?
Yeah, I don't remember what I searched, but I remember one of your early episodes was like the true cost of car ownership lives with from Frugal Woods, the episode of with compound interest. Like these were some of the buzzwords that I had learned in college. Like one of my engineering professors was like, compound interest is like one of the most important concepts you'll ever learn. And I was like, okay, this is probably important. So I'll like Google it. And at the time, like I was trying to look for podcasts because I just wanted something to have to listen to. And you guys were like one of the only ones that I like kind of could feel like I wasn't late.
Yeah.
To the party.
So I'm curious. So obviously you find this message early. and you've been here for hundreds of episodes. Like, what were the first couple of steps? Because as we always talk about, this is not about me and Jonathan, right? We're just, we're sharing this message as two friends, and people are listening. And most importantly, people are taking action. Do you recollect like what those first couple of actions you took were that like you realized, hey, I can actually change my life by just doing these small things?
Yeah. Well, I've always been the kind of person who was like, every 1% change I make is going to make me a little bit better. I just didn't know that there was like the term for like the aggregation of marginal gains that you always say. I had always been doing things like that throughout my entire life. And so the concept of making changes will affect my life later wasn't necessarily new to me. So it was just a matter of like, oh, wow, I have this new information, like, let's get on it. And I actually think the part about getting your mind accustomed to that, the change, is a lot harder than actually doing the steps. So many people find it difficult. You know, once they get complacent, they might not necessarily find it easy to get out of whatever situation they might be, unless they're like something catastrophic happens. And at that point, it might be a little harder than if you had started earlier.
You know, as I take a look at just a few of the things that you did during college, it kind of reminds me of some of the amazing kind of tips and tricks that people from this community have generally shared, some of them on this podcast. And I was genuinely curious, like, you know, you're an optimized guy, you're taking this, you know, 1% approach, you're coming in with work ethic and frugality, industry, and you're looking to optimize your college experience. Could you give us a little sense for, you know, what path you took during college, and if any of the actions that maybe people have shared on this podcast or in the community in the past inspired any of that?
Yeah. So in terms of like house hacking, Ed made me think about this actually. It was my grandma actually did real estate, and she house hacked. She like owns property in the Philippines where not only can she house my entire dad's side of the family, but she has like tenants as well. So her retirement is covered. All her children are covered in terms of like housing. And then on like for my family, not necessarily the having a roommate house hacking, but we did get a place that a tenant could live in. And my parents, being super frugal, they like saved up and were able to pay down the house in like 7 years. Wow. And they were really strategic. They picked a place that was like across the street from my elementary school and like in the same city as one of the best schools in the USA. And they were like, you have to go here. So, yeah, I don't know how they like managed to figure out that out with real estate, and their property value doubled over the year. So,
wow. So they are really locked in. And I mean, you said they came to the US in their 20s. Like, how on earth did they figure all of this stuff out? That's extraordinary.
My parents are really practical. They like had my brother when I was 10 years old. They like spaced us out just so that they could handle the financial burdens that might happen. If that makes sense, like saving for college, they were really practical. Like the babysitting example, the food example, like cooking, we didn't eat out very much, maybe like once every 2 months, just because, you know, it's like a nice thing to do. If anything, we had more like Taco Bell and Popeyes as like our special meal.
Been there. That's good stuff. Let's talk about the college, kind of the college hacking component, because you were able to kind of carry some of those lessons learned, my understanding is, and figure out a room and board situation at your college as well. I'd love to hear a little bit about, you know, what you did and how that affected your cost of college and your experience.
Yeah. So just to clarify, I have since graduated, but I actually didn't do the RA route. If I could go back, I wish I could. Now, in terms of like after graduation, and now I'm working post college. I live in Chicago, and one of the universities here offers basically a live-in housing director that doesn't necessarily have to be working at the university. So to clarify, at other institutions, this position would be called like residence hall director, where one person has to be working as the residence hall director, and then they can have like a partner or a spouse live with them. Whereas in this position, the difference is one person. The person doesn't have to be working as a residence hall director. they could be affiliated as a full-time student or as a faculty member doing something else. So we have people in the role, you know, working as nurses in the university hospital, or they can be like operations people. As long as you're a faculty member or a staff member at this university, you can apply for this quote-unquote residence hall director position equivalent. So that's like the difference from this institution than other institutions.
Just to clarify, I want to clarify, this is not a college hack per se as much as a living and residence hack. Is that accurate?
It's a living and residence hack, yes. Yeah, it's confusing to explain to people because of the aspect of when you think of residence hall director, like that's your job, but my job isn't residence hall director. My title is resident head, but I'm not affiliated to the university. Like my partner is a full-time student, but they're also, full-time working somewhere else in Chicago. And then our boss is the residence hall director. Another way to explain it is like there's a residence hall director and then there's the RA. The RA usually reports to the residence hall director. We're the in-between. So RAs report to us and then we report to the residence hall director. But the whole point of our position is just to be like real working adults for college students to like ask for guidance.
Yeah, that's really cool. And that was the part that I actually wanted to see if this is replicable, basically, for other people in the Phi community. So, you know, clearly there's RA as an undergrad, right? Mm-hmm. And you can be an RA. It depends on the college. Some give room and board, some give, you know, just free housing. But, you know, that's going to depend on the college. I think a lot of us are familiar with that. This live-in housing director, totally separate thing. I've never heard of this before, frankly. So this is awesome. Like, I mean, you're an original member of the Choose a Vi community. You know the kind of hacks that we love here. Is this something that other people theoretically could do? Is this just at this one university, to your knowledge? Like, I love that concept of having live-in adults, right? Like, that's really neat. But again, I've never heard of that before. Like, can you give some flavor on if you've heard of other schools doing this?
Yeah, so this school is one of the only ones that I know of so far. It might be called something else at other institutions. And if you were to go to other institutions, then the job would be your job, residence hall director. And then you could have a partner who does something else. So in that sense, it's replicable. It's kind of like if you want something for free, you should do it for work. I'm a fitness trainer, for example. I get free gym memberships if I like apply to be one of their fitness trainers, something like that. So in this example, if I want free housing, I would go to an institution that offered housing and work that as my job.
Yeah. And I think I remember Liz from Frugal Woods, I believe it was Liz, talking about she wanted to do yoga, but it was extraordinarily expensive. So she was able to volunteer in some capacity and wind up getting her monthly membership for free. So that's what it reminds me of when you're talking about, you know, the fitness and such. And I just love that, you know, you have a master's in engineering and, you know, you're a graduate, you obviously have a real job. And I mean, this is a way to house hack. It's brilliant. I mean, and like you said, it goes back generations. Your grandma is house hacking in the Philippines. I mean, it's remarkable to see these threads. And I love that you're constantly on the lookout for these little hacks. So yeah, this is an awesome one.
And so I am fascinated by this as well. Again, with Brad, echo his sentiments. I've never heard of this before. I am just wondering generally about like, who is this for? And for you, like, what's the appeal? Is this like a stepping stone stage thing? Or is this like, I hope not anybody else finds out about this because I'm gonna keep doing this forever type thing?
Right. What's the end game, right? Like that's...
Yeah. Like, what's the end game here? So, you know, is there compensation? So I would imagine it's room and board. Is it meals? Is it compensation on top of that? Are there hourly duty? Like, I'm just trying to get a sense for how much of your world does this consume? But it sounds like you can have another career or job on top of this pretty handily. And you're just getting, they're asking you to be there with these benefits just to be an adult in the place, you know, for some level of perpetuity. Give me a sense for like your assessment of this now, having done this for a bit.
Yeah. So room and board is covered, food is covered, utilities covered. And in terms of responsibilities, we basically do programming. We're given a budget every quarter for the students to do programming. And we do get a stipend on top of that. And because it's part-time, we can have full-time jobs outside of this. So I'm working full-time in Salesforce. I have like volunteering on the side and a few other positions, but Yeah. And I can bring this all back to the students and say, hey, this is some real world experience that I have. And I'm like a bridge between you and adulthood.
That's so cool. And this might be a stupid question, but it is 12 months a year, right? You're not getting kicked out during the summer?
No, not that I'm aware of. Yeah. We're here in the summer.
That'll be a rude
awakening. They turn off the heat and the AC in Chicago, but we're still here. No, that's amazing. Wow, dude.
That's really cool.
So full-time career and free living cost, and they have a good
free food,
free
utilities.
Yeah, I mean, you know, if you're not free in a 10x10 square of a room, then, well, I guess for some minimalists, that's even a thing as well. But I mean, assuming your accommodations are, how do you feel about your accommodations? Would you give them is this feel like a basement house hack, or do you feel like you're taken care of pretty well?
Let's just say we're taken care of very well.
Wow.
Yes, nice. We're in a new building.
Wow.
So.
Awesome. Okay. We're going to move this ship along, but what is the actual title? And like, if someone were to go to random college to see if they had something like this, what would be like the buzzwords that they would look for?
So the title officially is Resident Head, but the equivalent at other institutions, because Resident Head is pretty specific to mine, the title would be Residence Hall Director. And the caveat difference is Residence Hall Director is your job. Your full-time job is being a Residence Hall Director, despite all the, you know, perks that come with it, being able to live there, getting the food, all that stuff. Your job is Residence Hall Director, whereas with my job, you can be affiliated as a full-time student or as a staff member working somewhere else at the institution, and you can also be doing Resident Head.
So Denison's got a pretty nice setup, and we're not going to, if you're interested in Residence Head, why don't you just use the wonderful World Wide Web and see what universities offer residence head positions, and you can then see if you can dig something up. Be creative, people. Get Googling. Okay, now we're going to move on because you mentioned Salesforce, and obviously this is something that we're pretty passionate about, and we've seen a lot of success with. I'm curious a little bit about your Salesforce story, especially if you could put yourself back circa 2020, like how do we get to the situation where you're living for free, you got the situation, and you actually also have, you know, this remote work job? Like, is this something you've been doing for a while, or was there a transition period here?
There was definitely a transition period. At the beginning of 2020, I had been working as an industrial engineering consultant for about 2 years prior to that. And I said, hey, I think I have a little bit of runway. I think I would want to pursue health and wellness full time. I had also been a massage therapist and fitness trainer somewhere else working part-time. So I wanted to take that full-time in January 2020. A few months later, the pandemic basically furloughed me from being able to touch people through massage and any in-person activities. So the timing is really not favorable. So I was like, oh, shoot, I should go back to engineering. And so I had tried job hunting and all that stuff, and I wasn't landing anywhere. And so I remembered, if I had the opportunity to learn something new and try a new career, Salesforce is one of those things that was like, huh, if I could learn this, and if what they're saying is true, then I could have this lucrative career in something that I could learn relatively quickly, I feel.
So I just want to clarify, you actually heard, like, Salesforce was not on your radar and you heard us. It was because you heard us talking about it on the show.
Yeah, I don't remember what episode, but it was the episode where Bradley was first on and he was talking about working part-time after, you know, working in Salesforce for a few years.
Okay.
That's cool. Yeah, that was episode 117. And obviously you've been listening since the beginning. So that was, that was in March of 2019, actually. And yeah, I was astounded by that episode, just learning how much he could make at basically a part-time job, and, you know, his own, I guess, own, it seemed like his own consultancy, basically, right? Like, it wasn't, hey, I need to clock in for 40 hours. So yeah, that was intriguing to me. And so I just wanted to just stop and slow down real quick. So you're on the Phi path, right? You're doing all these little optimizations. You were an industrial engineer, but it sounds like you made a Phi decision from a position of strength to even make that original move, right? Like, how did the Phi mentality and concepts factor into that original decision? Because I think this is the cascade that leads to everything afterwards.
Well, I wasn't planning on a pandemic.
You don't say.
Yeah. So my initial thought process was, you know, I had built enough runway to be able to survive for a while in case, because what I had to do with health and wellness was kind of ramp up in terms of hours. Like if I didn't work, I wasn't going to get paid. So I needed to build my client base in terms of like fitness and massage clients. And then ideally, like the costs, like the amount I would be making would be able to be more than what I was spending. But that was with the pandemic, I had to be a little bit, I had to be really flexible and really consider like, okay, I really can't bank on massage being my career in the next few months. Like I have to make a pivot back to something else. And so, yeah, just being flexible was what led me to keeping Salesforce in mind, I would say.
Yeah, that's cool. I wonder like how close, so in that moment, right? Like it's whatever, April of 2020, May of 2020. And you have this, oh, shoot, moment, as you said, like, hey, you know, I can't be near people. How close were you to going back to industrial engineering? Like, was that, you know, put yourself in that moment. Like, was it, I mean, thinking about sending in resumes, like how close were you?
Yeah, no, I was pretty like on it in terms of I was back to, okay, I should fall back on engineering. This is my other skill set. Let me apply to jobs that would use my skill set. It's basically like a backup, kind of like how if I was in engineering and my backup was health and wellness, now I have a third backup as Salesforce. So just kind of building that on that talent stack. Yeah, just having all these different skills to fall back on, you know, in case something happens.
It's funny, you had truly had one of those. All right, I'm going to be brave here. I'm going to flex my financial independence model. I may not be full financial independence, but I have FU money. And then you say, and what's the worst that can happen? And then I'll be darned if 2 months later, the worst that could happen actually happened. You fundamentally are in an environment that does not allow you to do the job. And I don't know, I'm curious. And I think Brad was hinting that, like, was there, did panic really set in? Or even at that point, you're like, I've got this because at my core, I've got no life cost. My life is free room and board and meals. And so my baseline, this is the nice thing, right? If you've actually locked down your core expenses, your resilience is phenomenal. And then you're like, all right, I can go knock on doors, or the alternative of that, you know, in the engineering field, and I can go back and get an engineering job, or I've got runway. Would I like to pivot and maybe a previously not considered direction? And that's kind of like that's kind of the place, the triage map that you're looking at. I've got runway, my life doesn't cost anything. I was really getting tired of engineering. And there's right now in the short term, there's no like discernible way to crush massage therapy. That is that kind of about where you were?
Well, I actually didn't have this resident head role until August of 2020. So prior to that, it was really stressful in terms of living costs, because my partner and I had just bought a house 2 years ago, yeah. 2 years ago now. And so we were just early into the mortgage, and then our tenants moved out, and we had a duplex that our tenants moved out, and it was like, oh shoot, like how are we gonna pay every month? But then we figured out our finances, and we ended up getting the house all sorted out, and we also got the resident head position, which helped us save a lot of money. So to kind of like give clarity to what you were painting. It was a little scary at the beginning because I was like, oh, shoot, I don't have a job. There's this mortgage that I like, we need to pay. How are we going to pay it? Just kind of taking a chance on the resident opportunity. I was like, this sounds a little too good to be true, that we can live for free at this university and also get free meals. And we ended up getting the position, and then we ended up getting tenants. I got a job in Salesforce, like, and things are picking back up. We actually like saved a lot of money during that entire year just because of all the different frugality minded things that we did.
So Dennison, you keep saying like, you know, I got a job in Salesforce, and I'm curious, like, A, what does that mean? You know, for me as like somebody who's not in that world, what does that mean? And how did you get from here to there? Like that's that bridge piece that I'm so curious about. So obviously I know the job arc until then. You're furloughed, you're out of a job. Okay, you have this skill set. You went to get a master's degree in engineering, but you also heard this one random podcast a year before, right? And it's like, how did that weave itself into, wow, this is not just a random podcast, but this is something that I'm going to do research on, this is real, I'm going to pursue this. And I think this can be a better option, a much better option than what I spent 5 or 6 years going to college for. Like that, that's the story that intrigues me, because you had a fallback plan, right? Like it might not have been your ideal scenario, but you had a fallback plan in a, you know, pretty reliable industry, but yet you made this significant decision. And, you know, obviously the punchline is it worked out great, but you didn't know that at the time. Like talk me through that, that thought process, because this is critical.
I think part of your question that I'm thinking about is, I'm very open to learning new things. And so when I hear something on the podcast, I'm like, oh, that's really cool. I wish I had like the time to do it. It's like something I'll keep in my mental back pocket. And that's kind of what I would want to do once I'm, you know, FI. But in terms of like having to make a pivot when I was going through what option, like what career options I could pursue, Salesforce is definitely one of those like, this is something that, you know, Bradley talked about. You can make a starting salary of 60 to 80K, like as a junior Salesforce administrator. And I was like, okay, that sounds really cool. Like, what does that entail? And basically, I came to learn that Salesforce is just like a customer relationship management tool, helping different organizations manage their sales process and like their, you know, customer support processes. And so Salesforce administration is just managing that tool for these organizations. Different people can use the tool for whatever purpose they need. So for example, salespeople use it, you know, customer service people use it, and then Salesforce administrators are the people who are managing this tool. It's like being a Microsoft Excel wizard if everything in your company was, you know, in Microsoft Excel. You knew all of the like back-end stuff on Microsoft Excel and could make it work to any employee of the company. That's kind of what Salesforce was, at least how I understood it.
Gotcha. So it really is like an essential part of like kind of going back to that you're always be learning the mental skills, right? It's just another thing in your toolbox. And I guess you're saying this CRM is used, it's not, you're not working necessarily at Salesforce. It's that tens upon tens of thousands, probably hundreds of thousands or millions of companies are using this CRM in their own businesses. And you could theoretically then be hired at one of any of these businesses. Am I understanding the whole landscape properly?
Correct. And as I understand it, like the cost of the license per user per month is around $150. And so if you have, you know, 10 users, that's like $1,500 a month that an organization is paying. And so the reason salaries can get so high is because when you have like 100 people, you're paying $15,000 a month. So you want someone who's really competent in using this tool, you know, managing your tool. And so that's why I was, as I was learning more, I was like, okay, it's believable that these salaries are like something that an administrator would get paid.
The part that's so fascinating about this is that, you know, and still amazes me to this day, even though I helped, you know, Bradley kind of craft how this would, you know, is this really replicable, Bradley? Can people really get the results that we talked about that you said you got? Is it really possible for other people to get it? Because it sounds like we have been trained almost since birth that you need the 4-year degree to be able to get the job. And to get the upper, you know, median income jobs, you're going to have to get the 4-year degree. And don't worry about the fact that, like, you know, once you get the job, that's when you're going to really learn how to get the job. So immediately in my mind, even though that sounds broken at face value, and I was like, that's crazy, I'm going to learn how to do the job when I get the job, but I still need the 4-year degree to get the job. Like, really? Come, you know, even though in my mind, I associate learning a new skill and having an employer value me at the price for that skill of about 4 years of education. You need to study something for 4 years. In order to then be able to pay, you know, to be valued. And you know, I would love for you to just highlight to people your timeline for the first time that you really considered it to the point where you, you know, took action and went through the process. Like, give people a sense for how long it came to be an outsider to someone that's being valued as a junior Salesforce admin. What was that arc? What did that arc look like for you?
I think it was less than 2 years, I would say, which is way shorter than getting an undergraduate degree. From when I first heard the podcast up until 2 years later, getting a junior Salesforce administrator role. And I didn't even take action on when I first heard it. It was more of I was thrust into it because of the pandemic. So from that point, it was really about 6 to 9 months. And then really those first few months were just kind of bumbling around because I really had no direction. And then when I joined the program in November of 2020, the Talent Stacker program, that was when I was like, okay, these are like the steps to follow. And, you know, the steps aren't like super crazy. It was just more of the, oh, this is the guidance that I needed that I didn't have. And I'm kind of the proof of if you follow the steps, you can get a job in less than 6 months. I just happened to get it in less than 40 days.
All right. Brad, I'll give that one back to you. I just wanted to highlight, like, he started conservatively with a 2-year window here. And then he said, you know what, actually, you know, 2-year awareness of Salesforce, that was like 2 years ago. I took action on it during the middle of like craziness and, you know, and during this pivot. And so then kind of 9 months and a little, I was kind of checking it out on my own. And then I joined the program in November and in Dennis, did you say 40 days? Like just to clarify here, 40 days from the time that you actually joined Bradley's program that you had a job offer?
Yep. And it was within the advertised 60 to 80K starting salary.
That's unreal. That is really unreal. And so I just want to go back because, again, Jonathan said his first question to Bradley Rice originally when hearing this is it replicable? And because, you know, you hear when you know nothing about this. It's, oh, what is Salesforce? Is this just working for one company? And obviously we've already described that this can be working for one of many, many companies. And I just want to understand again, like the actual job. So are you, it almost sounded like in that example you were saying with 100 people or, you know, using Salesforce in this one company, like you are kind of like the in-house expert, right? So I'm assuming you're doing some kind of troubleshooting, not help desk in the low level, but like you're helping people implement this. And then I would assume, is there some level of like you also like troubleshooting for the company as a whole, like how they implement Salesforce, or is that like at a higher level? Or talk me through like, what does this look like, I guess, as an entry level job?
Yeah, so it honestly depends on how the org is or what the org is. So for example, for my full-time role, we are a sales company. And so we have sales processes and we also have customer service processes. And so all these processes live in Salesforce. And so my job is to make sure that their tool, the Salesforce, the tool that they're using is not only running well, but also seeing how I can improve it. So Salesforce is, you can modify it to make it more specific to your team, but also improve it to automate processes. So saving people time and money.
And Dennison, I'm really, you know, as you start talking about those things that actually move the bottom line for your company, are you actually to now, as a person that also like watches dollars and cents of the personal, are you also able to kind of appreciate the value more that you bring this company? Like you're legitimately, I would imagine, helping them earn more and spend less by dialing in all of this incredible software, but only if you know how to use it and know how to get the full flex out of what it's capable of doing. Like, are you starting to see how your abilities are making this company more profitable and be able to run leaner?
For sure. Yeah. With Salesforce, the value is instantaneously noticeable. In other positions, I would say the value is not as immediate. Whereas with Salesforce, I could change one little button and suddenly everyone like saves 2 hours of their day.
Yeah.
Whereas like in, you know, older company, like my old company, I would do something and I'm like, I don't know if I improved anything. Like, I don't know if I moved the needle on anything.
This is really important. I mean, this is why I wanted to go with this. I, as a pharmacist, highly compensated, I was making probably 120 to 130, you know, kind of on that very high end. I was the most expensive widget maker in the shop. It was very expensive. I could never quantify my value. We could take a look at medications sold, I guess, per year, gross profit, but it was, you know, it was very bleak. You were a drag on the company's, you know, and nothing you could do, working harder, being more friendly, you know, doing better customer service, like none of these things you could really attribute to more than an anomaly at the end of the day. Whereas what you're doing is, you can absolutely categorically point to the impact that you're having on every aspect of what the company does. And I just say, I find that fascinating as a small business owner myself. I find that an incredibly valuable thing to be able to recognize about your role in a company.
Yeah. And it makes me feel good that I'll have, in a sense, job security, knowing that not my org isn't the only org that uses this, but it's used all over the world. And it's something that I can do remotely, potentially, like like forever, basically. Just knowing that I can deliver this value cost-wise, you know, time-wise to these organizations just by knowing this tool. And, you know, Bradley said, like, you can stay as a Salesforce administrator and have a career just being an administrator. If you want, you can be an administrator, a Salesforce administrator for the rest of your career and like become Phi that way. But there are so many more options within the Salesforce ecosystem. And that's just Salesforce administration is just kind of scratching the surface. But to be able to reach Phi with just the baseline is pretty neat, I would say.
Yeah, that is incredible. I love how this was not even on your radar screen. And then you decided, all right, this is something I'm going to learn about. And boom. I mean, in that short a period of time, that's remarkable. Again, kind of going back to, is this replicable? And you as an original Choose a Vi listener, like, you know the type of hacks that we're looking for, right? That's why we're spending so much time on this. Because we think that this is something that other people can listen to and say, oh, wow, I want to pivot. Or, oh, wow, this is something I could do as a bridge to FI, or maybe in a pseudo early retirement, I could work 5 or 10 hours a week, something like that. Like, it seems as if, to me at least, this gives people options. And I think that's why I like highlighting this career change so much on the podcast. I think it's something that is really genuinely valuable to our community.
Dennison, I'm curious, when you really got serious about Salesforce and you started diving in, did you take the free 5-day challenge that we put together?
I did. I told Bradley about it. I was like, your 5-day challenge is what kind of pushed me to explore it a little bit more. I did take the 5-day challenge.
And would you, if someone else were listening to this thinking like they're kind of on the fence, what is this? Should I do research? Do you think Bradley was really trying to accomplish was just make the, if you just want to find out more, like you can just go do this yourself. You know, here are the things that you need to know. Would you agree that that is probably the place to start for any, like, as opposed to just a generic Google search, they should just start with this free 5-day challenge?
I would say so. Yeah. I took the challenge back in late August, early September. And I would say it's a really good starting point. And yeah, I think, like, you know, if you're really self-sufficient, you can make something out of the 5-day challenge your own. Yeah, I would say it's like, I always like share it with people, actually. I just say like, hey, if you want to learn a little bit more about making Salesforce a career path for you, you know, why don't you look into this 5-day challenge and we can talk about it, because, you know, I did it. I'm in the program, in the weeds, I'm in the Salesforce ecosystem. So,
well, congratulations to you and all you've accomplished in such a short period of time. What does this mean? Have you ever calculated now? So you have no living cost and you've got an income that is like a freaking rocket ship. Like, I mean, in your mind, where would you tell people, like, what's the range if someone in a Salesforce career, what's the range of salary that someone over a 10-year period could, if they were really gaming this thing out, where could they be 5 years from now? And what could they, what's the salary range, or maybe salary or just income range that would be attainable in a Salesforce career?
Yeah, starting salary is about 60 to 80K for a junior role. And then a year or two into Salesforce administration, it would be 80 to 100. And then year three and on is six figures. And that's not even including, you know, taking on part-time projects or independent consulting. So you can boost your salary, your earnings or your income with those side projects. And eventually, like, I guess the dream for a lot of people is doing what Bradley Rice is doing, where he has a handful of clients and he makes over $200,000, you know, a year, you know, taking on these clients as an independent consultant.
Yeah. And I guess where Jonathan, I think, was ultimately going to land on that is, so what's your Phi date, right? Have you calculated, you're an ultra optimizer, your life costs nothing. Do you have any sense of not necessarily an early retirement, but just your Phi date? Do you have any clue?
I actually don't, which I feel like, as I'm saying, is really surprising, because I'm actually the kind of person who doesn't budget. I do it from the other side, where I start really with nothing and then build up from there and see what I can cut out versus like expand on everything and then cut down. And so I'm pretty happy doing it that way, because when I looked at my finances, I'm like, oh, I've already hit over 100K in my my own personal savings. So I don't have a date, but I do trust that I'm getting there, and I at some point I'll calculate it. But right now I'm just kind of trying to figure, the whirlwind of things happening.
And you got it. You don't know. Yeah. It's just right. It. Changes, right? It's awesome. But you are certainly on the simple path now, man. You've got this thing figured out. So I just want to say huge congratulations to you. And thanks for joining us on the show today.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you for having me.
All right, everyone. These are the types of stories. I hope you just appreciate the fact that we love, absolutely love to feature stories from people inside the community that took action on content that they'd heard this community talk about and saw their life change for the better. And maybe even it wasn't immediately straight up. Like they took a recommended action, life pushed back, and then they realized they'd unlocked flexibility and they pivoted in a different direction. The fact that, if a pandemic hits you and your career plans, your retirement plans, your anything, let's say that just something happens and it knocks you on your tail and you realize you can pivot in a period of months, be in a new industry, making maybe more than you were before, that should give you the confidence that the world is unlocked. And so, for what it's worth, and you want to do what Dennison did, start with just a free challenge, right? Just find out a little bit more about this. Go to choosefi.com/322. That's choosefi.com/322. And just, get a little more information. See if maybe this is something that would be beneficial for you, if this is something that would unlock some options. All right, my friends, the fire is spreading. We'll see you next time as we continue to go down the road less traveled.